and welcome to another episode of Earth 911 Sustainability in Your Ear. And we have an innovator interview today with Mitch Vestal, who is the founder and CEO of PlaySafe, an ice melt and yard care company that has specialized in building or making products that are safe for our children and pets, as well as the environment. And Mitch reached out talking about de-icing, which leads to what is called chloride poisoning in waterways. And I wanted to get him on the air and share this idea with all of you out there. Mitch, welcome to the show. How are you today?
I am great. Good to be with you.
Well, thank you for joining us. Listen, it's late. Actually, it's early March. We've got a little more ice coming this year. But tell us about how de-icing works, because I don't think a lot of people understand that the salt that we spread on our streets and on our driveways and on our walkways can easily end up in our local waterways and result in poisoning. What happens with chloride poisoning?
Well, there's two questions. Let me start just by saying that when you apply, when you have ice to remove, mm-hmm. And you spread salt on top of that ice, nothing happens if the weather's too cold or if there's not enough moisture, because the salt has to dissolve into a liquid to penetrate the ice, get to the base level, and help break the bond that has occurred between the ice and the surface it's on.
That's why you see the pits in the ice from the ice pellet the salt pellet, is that it's melted locally, but it hasn't melted comprehensively.
Yes, it actually bores its way to the surface, mm-hmm. where it's trying to break the bond with the surface. Mm-hmm. So so it's burning a lot of energy in dissolving itself. And the difficult thing is there's only three chlorides, and they're obviously all salts, that will melt, that have been used to melt ice since the 1950s when it all began. You got sodium chloride, which works in the most narrow band to about 15 degrees. Mm-hmm. You got magnesium chloride, which practical effective temperature works to about zero. And you've got the superstar, which is calcium chloride, which is the most effective in cold weather, and it actually heats up the melt ice, and it works down to minus 20. But if you're going to buy a granular ice melt product, they all begin the same way. You put them down as a solid. They'll begin to dissolve if it's not too cold. And from there, the dissolved salt helps break the bond. The thing to remember about that process is the salt never really totally dissolves.
Right.
And it is very mobile because the ground doesn't catch it. Mm-hmm. And it'll always track and find, 90% of all the salt applied ends up in a waterway. It'll get there. It'll get into groundwater. It'll get into stream water. It'll get into your wastewater system that your municipality deals with. And it'll certainly, when they spread it onto highways and roads, it'll get into natural water, either through tributaries or lakes. And the important thing to remember is, when we apply as a population tens of thousands of pounds of salt each year, and they never go away. They all accumulate.
I myself live on a lake, and I have seen the runoff, the dried runoff, which is white, right? It's salty. It's dried salt running downhill into the lake. And I know our lake has continued to have a variety of environmental problems as a result of that and other things, including fertilizer. Now, you offer a liquid as compared to a solid ice melt. What's the difference between the liquid and the solids in terms of the chemicals that are left over afterwards?
Well, it's exactly the right sequence to think about. I'll say two things about your question. Liquids, most liquids that are used, certainly by highway departments of transportation, mm-hmm. are liquefied salts. So what they've done is mimic the natural process that takes place to put it down before snow begins. And what happens, it retards the ability of ice to fuse to the surface. Mm-hmm. And you'll use fractions amounts of salt to prevent ice than you will to remove ice. And let me just put this, for people keeping score at home, here's an incredible number that most people don't know. It only takes a teaspoon of salt to ruin 5 gallons of water.
Right.
For any aquatic life. And that is, that's documented by Minnesota and Wisconsin Department of the Environment. So it's a compelling number. And you just think about all of those hundreds of thousands of tons of ice melt that have been put down since the 90s. And you can, and that's why you see the problems you're seeing in your lake there.
And you, you know, you pointed out to me when we first started talking that, you know, the average home in a, in an icy area may put on 200 to 800 pounds of this stuff in a year. That's incredible.
Well, it is. And it's necessary because, you know, the only thing, it's an immediate safety hazard and it's got to be removed. You know, local homeowners, depending on where you live, get fined if you don't remove ice. And you've only got two options. One is to use ice and make, or use salt and make your job easier, or go out there and really grind away at removing ice, unless and until someone actually makes a product that the residential user can use pretty much just like a brine truck uses to reduce salt use on the roads, mm-hmm. which is really kind of the answer to part B of what you asked me a second ago. Our product, you actually pour right into a hand sprayer and you apply it. And much like spraying Pam on a frying pan, although it's not slippery, it keeps ice from fusing to the surface.
And you would you'd do this in a few days before the storm arrived, as I understand it. Is that correct?
I answer the question this way. You got to remember that most of these salt brines are 23% to maybe 35% salt. Mm-hmm. So I'm not crazy about applying those too soon around the home for home use. You need to be mindful of, your concrete can only take so much. Certainly if you're using on decks, you'd worry about any metal fasteners corroding. The great thing about liquids versus pellets. So as we said earlier, if you're using a granular ice melt, there's only three options, the three chlorides. That's really all that's out there. Some PetSafe brands will use urea, but it really stinks as an ice melting product. It doesn't work. It doesn't dissolve in cold weather. But you're really limited to the three chlorides. When you go to the liquid applications, it opens the playing field up to many more ingredients that can be chloride free. Some are even organic. We use potassium acetate and CMA, which are the acetate family is very friendly to turf systems. It's actually it enhances nutrient take up by the soil, and it doesn't travel into the waterways the way salt does.
Because it actually is absorbed by the local soils. And so so let me just make sure that I understand. You're replacing a set of chloride of salts with a set of acetates, which are better for the local environment as well.
Correct. And so when you put the acetate down beforehand, because there's no salt, you can put that down a couple of days beforehand. You don't worry about anything being adversely affected versus a salt brine. Mm-hmm. But the purpose of this, and this is key, because there's as with any new technology, you get people that market this, and I think they sometimes do a disservice to the product set. These anti-icers don't keep ice from accumulating or snow from accumulating. What they do is keep the moisture that seeps out of the snow from fusing to the surface and bonding to the ice. Mm-hmm. So you're still going to have to go out. You're going to put it down. You're going to have the snow stop, and when you go outside, you're going to notice something wet and slushy underneath the snow, mm-hmm. and that's thanks to our product, and it makes it easy to remove. So it becomes a two-step process. It snows, you shovel the process, you shovel everything away, and you go back inside, as opposed to a traditional de-icer, where you're going to go shovel the snow off, slip around on the ice, put ice melt down in some application rate per square foot, not knowing if it's enough, and then go back out in an hour and see if it worked or not.
Right.
And then you're going to remove the ice. So you've added two or three more steps to a process that really doesn't mimic what best practices is. And the products we use are heavily tested on airstrips, bridges, highways. The great thing about these products is that this whole anti-icing category, there's not any question. This is not new technology now. It's been proven, and it's just we're just transferring best practices from the commercial category into the residential space.
So let's also talk about how this changes the safety of the product for pets and children, because that's the other compelling concern that a lot of people respond to. Now, you know, obviously rock salt, which is mostly what we're talking about with many of the products out there, can get stuck in the paws of a dog. They lick it. It causes both toxic effects in their body, and it can aggravate their skin. What's the difference when you use a liquid? You know, obviously it doesn't stick between the paws. Why is this safer for kids and pets?
If I were to put the all of the advantages into a pie chart, what you just described is probably half of it. There's just nothing to get stuck into a paw. And it's incredible. If you go to Amazon and you Google on Pet Safe Ice Melt, they're all going to be pellets and they're all going to be chloride salts labeled as safe. It's difficult for me to understand because, well, they're not, because they're all chloride salts. When you look at the ingredients, if you can find them, another important thing to remember is that this category isn't regulated by anybody. So
really
the claims don't really have to be tethered to the ingredients, and seldom are they. And so a dog on the label becomes a, you know, a seller, and people then use products in a way, because they're pet labeled, in a way that's really not in the best interest of the animal. So to your point, we wouldn't walk around on those pellets barefooted. Pets aren't crazy about it either. If they could buy something, they wouldn't buy that product. And they certainly wouldn't want to go out on it until it was removed from the surface. Having said that, to answer your question, so when you put down a liquid, it stays where you spray it. So it doesn't come walking inside in the bottom of shoes or in paws. So it's also cleaner on floors, but for pet safety, it's non-toxic. There's no chlorides. You know, dogs, all animals are attracted to salt. They like, you know, they will find it. Many. Yeah. And now, our product, for one, actually is going to smell more like vinegar, which appeals to very few, if any, animals. But you have, if you're looking for a chloride-free product out there, the ureas are... the urea-based product ice melts are safe. The only thing that concerns us in a little bit is they all get laced with some ethylene glycol or some propylene glycol. They don't typically tell you how much is in that product, but from an irritation standpoint, a corrosive standpoint, the urea products are certainly more accurately labeled than the rest of the brand set, yet they only make up about 10% of the pet market. So if you're looking for products and you want to know one that's really safe, just don't buy any. Don't treat a product that doesn't say chloride free and it is safe. It's just not.
And the urea is not quite as effective as I understand, but it also, because it's a nitrate, would that contribute to local water pollution as well?
Well, that's a tremendous question, because if you look into the EPA standards, for example, at airport testing. Urea was once used some at airports, but because of the water testing standards that went into place in the late 90s, it really isn't used anymore, because urea is 46% nitrogen. And as it as nitrogen breaks down, it turns into ammonia. And obviously in the winter, it's not getting used by the soil, so it's running off immediately. If it does get taken up by the soil, it's going to burn whatever's there, because in most markets that need a lot of ice melt, putting down that much urea and then having the shovel remove it to a localized area really creates a problem for that turf. And most of those products will say to stop using the product if you see the grass turning yellow around it, which by then is obviously too late.
Okay.
But we're not, from a safety, you know, our passion is protecting families and pets. You know, you can reseed. It's a safer product for families with pets, and that's our, if that's your primary goal, you know, you can always, you know, throw down some new grass seed at the start of the season. We suggest it's easier to save yourself all that time and effort to remove ice to just prevent it in the first place.
Well, and not to mention the fact that it is better for the environment. So, you know, Mitch, this is great to hear. Everybody, check out PlaySafe Liquid Ice Blocker. It's at playsafeiceblocker.com. And Mitch Vestal, who is the CEO and founder of the company, is our guest today. Thanks very much for sharing this information about melting ice. I think it's still relevant as we go into the spring. I hope anybody out there listening makes the switch if they run into another ice event this year. Thanks, Mitch.
That was great. Thank you. It's a great fun.
Well, everybody, this is Mitch Ratcliffe. You're listening to earth911.com. We'll be back with another innovator interview soon. Take care, everyone.